Today's lesson, the all-sufficient God, for the needs of his people, the provision for a man in despair. Today's lesson, the provision for a man in despair. The provision for a man in despair. And the text is found in Genesis chapter 43, verses 13 through 15. Here beginneth the reading of God's holy word. Take also your brother and arise. Go again unto the man. And God Almighty give you mercy before the man, that he may send away your other brother and Benjamin, if I be bereaved of my children, I am bereaved. And the men took the presents, and they took double money in their hands, and Benjamin, and rose up, and went down to Egypt, and stood before Joseph. The text. And God Almighty give you mercy before the man, that he may send away your other brother and Benjamin, if I be bereaved of my children, I am bereaved. The provision for a man in despair. Our Heavenly Father, accept thanks from your faltering servants. We acknowledge that we're wholly devoid of the graces needed to perform the task before us. But we thank you for your mercies and indulgence. Lord, this brutish servant, employ your touch. Touch this mind. Grant unto it clarity of thought and precision of expression. Bend this will to conform to your will. But above all, Lord, let your word come forth in power. And grant that we shall only say those things that may be properly concluded from this passage. Do exceeding, do abundant, above all that we're able to think or ask of thee, according to the power that worketh in us. For all of these merits we beg, in the name of the crucified one, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Time is against us today, so I must move with some speed. In the Old Testament, names are an indication of a person's character, or it is a description of some peculiar quality that exists in a person. In a real sense, a name is given to describe a person or something about them. What is true of individuals is also true of God. Certain names or appellages have been given to him. And these names and appellages serve to describe who he is, or some peculiarity about his persona. We have been looking at the names Elohim, which means the God or the person who takes nothing, and out of no thing, he makes something. Elohim. It describes God in all of his creative properties. He needs nothing to work with, because he has the ability to create whatever he needs. And then after he creates it, he can convert it into something else. As a black man, this is particularly comforting to me. To know that God can take me where I am. With all of my faults and failures and frailties. And make me into what he desires me to be. But I have good news for you. That's not only true of me because I'm bald-headed. But it's also true of you. So even if somebody has given up on you, let God get a hold of you. For as Elohim, he takes nothing. And from no thing, he makes something. Isn't that wonderful? So Maurice, you don't have to give up. The God with whom we have to do, he starts with nothing. And if somebody cuss you out and tell you you are less than nothing, smile. Because you understand that's all God needs. The God that we serve, that's all he needs. He needs nothing. And with that he can make. Aren't you glad? You should have a smile on your face. Particularly if the devil is playing with your mind. And adversities surround you so. And all they do is to play up your weakness and your insufficiencies. It's good to know that the God that we worship can take people who are losers and make them winners. Then we looked at the prefix L-E-L in Elohim. And it's the ancient form of among the Hebrews and people of that region to describe God. El means to be strong, yes. E-L, to be mighty, to be powerful. Hence it comes over as God, the mighty one, the powerful one, the strong one. Isn't it good to know that your God is strong? Because I certainly am not. And that he's mighty and he's powerful. Hence it comes over in our Bible sometimes as God, El. And you find it in names like Bethel. Beth is the Hebrew word for house. El is the word for strong one or mighty one. Hence Bethel means the house of the strong one. The house of the mighty one. The house of the powerful one. Or are you with me? And Israel, you see it again. And the first part of the word means a prince. And of course the latter part means of the strong one, the mighty ones. So when God changed Jacob's name to Israel, he said, you're a prince of God. I wonder if we have some Israel in here. And that name was given to a guy who messed up all over the place. God said, when I'm through with you, you're not going to be called Jacob anymore. Your name will be Israel. You're going to be the prince of the mighty one. That's why I love God. Because he takes no good people. And he does something with them. And that's why I'm glad that I'm a member of this year church. For this year church preaches a big God. With whom nothing is impossible. Hallelujah. And I'm also glad that you come to this your church. Because in this church, every Sunday you hear about this great God and what he can do. So on Monday you can go face the adversities of life knowing that your God is a mighty God. But we've been examining another name, and you use El, the prefix El, the mighty one, the strong one, the powerful one. And it's coupled with another name, which is Shaddai. Shaddai. Hence, El Shaddai means the all-sufficient God. Or the almighty God for the needs of his people. And the latter part of the word shad or shade, actually, I must tell you, shad literally means the earth or to nourish. And you know, we get our nourishment from the earth. So it means the earth. And when it comes to individual, it means a breast. And one of the contraction means a mountain. So it means strong and high like a mountain. A powerful breast that nourishes and sustains. So our God is the one who nourishes us, sustains us, preserves us. But that's the Hebrews are not the only one who had the notion that God is to do this. A few years ago, Lady McKinley and I, we went to Turkey. And Turkey today is the country where the ancient city of Ephesus was, that region. We went to Turkey. And it's one of the best trips we have ever taken. And one of the things that struck me in Turkey as I journeyed and traveled through the seven churches of Asia Minor, and my guide, you know, he was quite a scholar, and we would read from the New Testament and look at the Greek and argue over the issues. When it came to the statuaries of Diana, who was the goddess of Ephesus, and she was supposed to be the sustainer of Ephesus, something stood out. And I don't know if Lady McKinley remembers, but this statue of Diana, according to the ancient Ephesian, it was covered with breasts. I mean, on her head, or top of her head, all around her head, all these breasts all over her, all down through, and her leg, the statue of Diana, was covered with breasts. And I said to my guide, it's rather peculiar. I knew that she was considered the sustainer, but I didn't know that she was covered all over. He said, the notion of sustenance is the breast. And if this is the God that sustains us, then she must have breasts everywhere. But I'm so glad that when the Hebrews thought of their God, they knew that we knew that our God is so powerful that he don't need to have a multiplicity of breasts. You only need one. That's how powerful our God is. The all-sufficient God. And remember, breast is critical. Any woman who breastfeeds her child, when she's feeding the child, it becomes something very intimate. Because you can't feed him on the breast and do other things. So when she's feeding him, she must stop everything and give him her undivided attention. So the notion is that when our God deals with us, he gives you his attention. Are you getting it? The idea of him being the mighty breast is the one who sustains us and shed forth sustenance. And he gives us his attention. Somebody looking at me all strange. I got to understand this and accept this. Because it means that when I'm in trouble, I need to know that the eyes of the Lord are on me and that the purpose of God surrounds me. That's the idea of the breast. And when the child is feeding on the breast, the mother does multiple tasks. For while he's feeding or she is feeding, the mother checks the diaper. If the child needs changing, she changes the diaper. Checks the child. If there's some malady afoot, she corrects that. Or are you with me? So while the child is attached, she does other things to the child. And it says that our God does multiple things for us. While he's taking care of one thing, he takes care of something else over there. And while he's taking care of that, he takes care of something else over there. He does multiple tasks, but they're all directed to the child that he's sustaining. Aren't you glad? It means that you are the object of his attention. Now, in that regard, let's look at today's sermon. Today's sermon, the provision for a man in despair. In the 43rd chapter of the book of Genesis, the first thing that occurred to me as I studied the passage is the notion that God begins to make provision for a thing years before it happened. There was a famine in the land, and the whole world was on the verge of bankruptcy. But 22 years before, God made provision for Jacob and his sons not to be swallowed up in the abyss of bankruptcy. But the problem is that Jacob and his son didn't know that God made provision for them. In the book, of Genesis chapter 37, verse 2. We're told there clearly that Joseph, when his brother sold him into slavery, he was 17 years old. Look at it. Genesis 37, 2. Joseph was 17 years old when his brother sold him. And down in the 28th verse of that same 37th chapter, we find that's when he was sold. So Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers when he was 17 years old. And if you notice, in Genesis 41, verses 46, when Joseph appears, Genesis 41, 46, when Joseph appeared before Pharaoh, we're told that he was 30 years old. Are you with me? He was 30 years old when he appeared before Pharaoh. So if he was sold when he was 17, and when he appeared before Pharaoh, they took him out of jail and brought him before Pharaoh, he was 30. It means it was 13 years later. 17 and 30, according to my math, is 30. So 13 years Joseph spent in jail. And all along, God got Joseph on the ground in Egypt, preparing for this famine. When God makes provision, he uses strange means and purposes to accomplish his purpose. Notice the means he used: slavery. Notice his brothers sold him. Pain and despair, separation, anxieties. Yet through all of this, God was making plans for Jacob and his children by separating Joseph. I think what I'm trying to tell you is that nothing that happens to you catches God by surprise. And that God has something in the works long before the problem comes. In the 45th chapter, the 6th verse, we find Joseph speaking to his brothers. And he's saying to them, this is the second year of the famine. The second year of the famine. And somebody said, well, that's 2 years later. No, it's 9 years later since he stood before Pharaoh. Because remember, there were 7 years of plenty. And then after the 7 years of plenty comes the 2 years of famine. So really, it's 9 years. Are you with me? That will make Joseph 39 years old. And you separate 17 from that, and you got 22. You got it? So now it's 22 years since Joseph went into slavery. 22 years before the famine started. God had a man on the ground. God had somebody in place to take care of Jacob. God made provision. He started out 22 years ago with a boy going into slavery. Now 22 years later, the guy is the second most powerful person in Egypt. The problem is, Jacob don't know anything about this. Somebody in here, you are worried. You are wringing your hands. How am I going to make it? How am I going to make it through? What's going to become of me? I have a word for you. 20 years ago, God set his Moses plan in motion. The problem is, you don't know nothing about it. You see, we need to understand that nothing catches you by surprise. Nothing that happens in your life goes without the notice of God. Before you got caught in this mess, God knew it was coming. And if God knew it was coming, he made provision. Turn to somebody and say, provision. In our text, we find Jacob in despair. We find Jacob really depressed. And I would like to point up to you in a few minutes the language of depression. In the 42nd chapter, verse 1. Listen to depression. When people are depressed, they don't do anything. They just stand around and look. They are frozen. You remember when you were depressed? You didn't do nothing. You just look. Don't comb your hair. Don't even wash yourself. Come on here. Come on here. Come on here. And I want you to know that you can be in that situation and still be a child of God. And a famine will bring depression your way. in the midst of the famine. Notice the first verse. And when Jacob saw that there was corn in Egypt, Jacob said unto his son, why do ye look one upon another? So the guys were standing around all depressed, looking at each other. Their cattle are dying. No water. Depression. Depression. Depression tends to demobilize us. Depression tends to cause us to throw up our hands. You sit back and feel sorry for yourself. Look in your wounds. Looking at your woman. Your woman looking at you. Won't go get a job. Won't even try. Beaten down so. The circumstances are of such that you lose the very will to try. This is the description that we find in 42:1. Depression. And we find the old man Jacob saying to his son, why are you standing around looking at each other? I want you to know, while they were depressed looking at each other, God's provision was already in place in Egypt. While the famine raged, God's provision was already in place. Now, don't you see why you must have faith? You need to have faith and trust in God. You're not trusting your ideas. You're not trusting your strength. You're trusting God. You need to understand that the God that we serve, he knows everything. One of the words that describes him, he's omniscient. He knows the beginning from the end. And whatever happens, it's according to his purpose. He sets it in motion. And if God knows what's coming, then he has already made provision for you to deal with it. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. God who makes provision. So somebody who's in despair, wake up. Here David in his, when David was depressed, he asked, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Hope thou in God. One of the cures for depression is self-talk. When you're depressed, one of the ways you deal with it is self-talk. You need to talk to yourself. You need to sit back and say some things to yourself. Why art thou cast down? Oh, my soul, hope thou in God. Somebody in here, in your depression, God saw you last night crying, feeling sorry for yourself, accusing him and blaming him. I want you to engage in some self-talk. You need to put your hands on your own breast and tell yourself, hope thou in God. Come, do it now, do it. Do it. Hope now in God. Good mental health. Good therapy. Jacob said in the second chapter to his, in the second verse of that 42nd chapter to his sons, go to Egypt and buy corn. For I heard that there is corn in Egypt. Notice, Egypt is not coming to Canaan. Canaan is going to Egypt. So don't play white folk no mind. The place that God provided to sustain them was Africa. Black folk and Africa has always been the breadbasket of the world. It's messed up today because white folk went there and messed it up, but let me move on. Go down to Egypt. There's corn there. Egypt don't come to Canaan. Canaan go to Egypt. And note also, when God wanted to preserve his people, where did he preserve them? In Egypt. They couldn't make it in Canaan. So we sent them to Egypt. In 42:6 and punch up 6 for me, my dear. This is a very critical verse. Joseph was the governor of the land of Egypt. And the Bible tells us, I think in the 6th verse, that he was the governor. Between the 6th and the 8th verses, that when his brothers came to Egypt, in the 6th verse, they bowed themselves down before him to the earth. The very thing that they wanted to kill him for. I don't have the time to make all of these observations. In chapter 37, verses 6 and 7, 6 and 8, 6 through 8, and 9 through 11, Joseph had two dreams. And he told his brother, I dreamt a dream. And my dream was that we were out in the fields binding sheaves. And your sheaves bow down and worship mine. And his brothers hated him. Said, you mean we're going to serve you and we're going to bow down to you? You are the youngest of the lot. And besides, our daddy loves you more than he loves us, and we're going to bow down to you? Never. And the Bible says they hated him. And the 9th through the 11th verses, again, he dreamt another dream. And the dream was that I saw that he saw that he was out in the fields, and the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bow down and pay obeisance to him. And again, they hated him. And when they saw him coming, they said, behold, the dreamer cometh. Let's kill him and see what will become of his dreams. I'm here to tell you that when God says something's going to happen, it doesn't matter who likes it or who don't like it or who wants to stop it. It doesn't matter. So they got rid of him. They sold him, or so they thought. Now, 22 years later, turn to somebody and say, 20 years. 20 years. Stevens, I don't quite know what I'm saying. But I feel in my spirit, and as I study the scriptures, I find that God works in 20-year cycles. Did you hear me? God works in 20-year cycles. 20 years later, the men came into Egypt. They didn't know who was sitting on the throne. All they knew is that they needed food, and they bowed, according to 42:6, and pay obeisance. The very thing they said they won't do. The very dream that they thought will never come to pass. That's why if you do business with God, you should learn that not to say never. Never say never. Never is too long. You need to say if it is the will of God. When God determined to do something, it will come to pass. And the Bible says that they bowed down and paid obeisance before Joseph. Acknowledge that he is in fact superior to them. In the 8th verse, we're told something else. And Joseph knew his brothers, but they knew not him. See, when God decides to turn things around, he'll give you the upper hand. You know what's going on, and they don't. They're bowing, paying obeisance. Joseph checking them out. He knew that these are the same guys who mess with him. But look at the 9th verse. Look at the 9th verse. And Joseph remembered the dreams which he dreamed of them, and said unto them, ye are spies. Notice, God keeps his word. That's what I'm trying to tell you. God keeps his word. Whatever God says is going to happen will happen. It doesn't matter how long it takes. Loris, are you listening? It doesn't matter how long. It doesn't matter who messed with you. It doesn't matter who tried to stop it. It doesn't matter who your enemies are. It doesn't matter who's trying to block you. It doesn't matter who's trying to keep it from happening. If God willed it, it will come to pass. Oh, I want the devil to know. And I want all the devil friends to know that if God said, it will come to pass. Joseph, remember. You know, while Joseph was in prison, he hurt, and it seemed like God was taking advantage of him. And I want you to know who this Joseph is. This is the same guy that was accused of attempted rape. So he had sitting over his head that he was an attempted rapist. And God did nothing to exonerate him. God never exonerated him. He still have this sitting over his head. Nevertheless, 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 never mind his reputation, nevertheless, tell you nobody can destroy your reputation, nevertheless, they can raise some question, but they can't destroy it. Whatever God got for you, you're going to get it. Oh, I don't know who I'm talking to, but somebody stumbled in here today. An accused rapist. Now he's sitting on the throne. Remembering the promises of God. I want somebody here to hear me. God's going to make you remember. You're going to live long enough to see it come to pass. Never mind how long it has been. Hi, Sister Allion. Never mind how long it has been. Or how hopeless It appears. God, you're going to live to see it. Here we have Joseph remembering all the mess they did. Remembering how impossible it has seemed. Now the guys are on their knees and their face before him, just like God said. In the 23rd and the 24th verses of the same 42nd chapter, we find Joseph putting them to the test. He spoke roughly to them and said to them, "You are spies, and you have come to spy out the land." And they said, "No, we're not spies. We are 12 brothers. One is not. 10 of us are here, and the younger is home with his father. He is his last son. He's his pride and joy, and we can't take him away from his father. His father will not be separated from him, because the youngest boy, our blood brother, his full brother, he is the one that's missing. And so the father, our father will not let him leave. Our father will let the 10 of us go, but that boy stays home with him." And Joseph says, "You can't come back and buy unless you bring him with you." And he said, "I want to be sure that you come back. So I'm going to take one of your brothers and put them in jail." And it's very significant that Joseph arrested Simeon. Tie him up and put him in jail. Remember, we talked about Simeon the other day. This was one of the rough brothers. Remember, this is one that committed murder. Wiped out a whole city. Remember, this is the rough brother. So Joseph got a hold of the rough one. Tie him up. Put him in jail. And incidentally, Simeon means, the name Simeon, it means hearing. And hearing in the Bible is a symbol of faith. So faith. Did you pick up? Faith is tied up in jail. Said to the other 9, "You can go home. But leave faith here." And if faith is here, you're going to have to come back. So he tied up faith and capped him. So you can go back. But I want you to know, all along, the guy that appeared to have been their enemy was God's provision. I don't think you're getting it. Incidentally, the name Joseph means added, to add another. That's what it means. Or it means increaser. So wherever Joseph is, there's going to be an increase. And he is the man that God sent ahead to make provision. So it seems that the person that God would use to make provision is usually the person that they beat up, that is abused, that is hated, that they want to get rid of, that they write off. Am I describing a Joseph in here? But that's the one that God uses invariably to feed them and to take care of them. So here we have Joseph tied up Simeon, kept Simeon, and said, "Go back, but you can't come back unless you bring your younger brother. Let me move quickly. I see you, I see you, I see you, I see you." And the Bible says that Jacob was depressed. Now, in chapter 42, where the text is, in chapter 42, 36, Jacob, in his depression, look at the 46th verse, the 36th verse in the 42nd chapter. I want you to hear the language of depression. We got the look of depression. The look was, you're looking at each other, you're frozen. Now, listen to the language, verse 36. "And Jacob, their father, said unto them, Me have ye bereaved of my children. Joseph is not. Simeon is not. And ye will take Benjamin away." Here is depression. "All these things are against me." When you're depressed, you feel like everything is against you. What Jacob thought was against him was really working for him. Are you with me? "All these things," he said, "are against me." Joseph is not. 22 years later, he's still talking about Joseph. This is the boy that's supposed to be dead. 22 years later, can't get him out of his mind. Joseph is not. Simeon is not. And now you will take Benjamin. All these things are against me. And if you look further, you will find that in the 20, in that same region there, we find that a guy by the name of Reuben stood up, the brother. And Reuben said, give, in the 37th verse, give me Simeon, I'll take him. I'll take him down and I'll bring him back. And the old man says in the 38th verse, no, you're not going to take my son. I don't trust you, Reuben. You cannot be trusted. See, Reuben was the firstborn. But the name Reuben means unstable. Actually, Reuben means to see. See a son, or the vision of a son. But the father, later describing him, said, you're unstable as water. You shall not excel. In other words, you are like, actually the text says in the Hebrew, you're unstable as boiling water. Have you ever seen boiling water? It's never settled. It's always jumping. That's what you like, Reuben. You're like boiling water. I want you to know, Jacob refused to trust anyone that was not settled, that was not stable, that was not dependable. He said, I won't give you my son. You go there and something happened, you can come back here without my son. And I'm going to go down to the grave. My gray hair will take me down to the grave in sorrow. No. And in the 43rd chapter, I want you to note in the 43rd chapter back there, Judah came into the picture. And Judah stood up and said to his father, in the third verse, Judah said to his father, I make a solemn promise to you, protestation, that I won't see your face again unless I bring him with you. Bring him with me. Judah means, may Jehovah be praised. Judah represents worship and praise. Are you with me? And in the 8th verse, Judah said to his father Israel, send the lad with me, and we will arise and go, that we may live and not die, both we and thou, and also our little one. And as Judah spoke, his father listened. I want you to know. And the father later said to Judah, you take him and go. In the 9th verse, Judah says, I will be surety for him. Of my hand shalt thou require him. If I bring him unto thee and set him before thee, then let me bear the blame forever. Notice, Judah means may Jehovah be praised. Judah means praise and worship. When nothing else will work, worship will. And if there's anybody you can trust, is a worshiper. For worship will make you steady. Worship makes you stable. Worship makes you unmovable. You see, worshipers don't get scared easy. Even when a worshiper does not understand, he stands his ground and worship. He may cry, but he believes. He may cry, but he holds on. A worshiper might be no storm, but he knows how to stand his ground and wait on God. And I want you to learn from Jacob. You might not be able to trust Reuben, but Pastor Bev, you can always trust Judah. Anybody who worships can be trusted. Even God, God trusts worshipers, and God loves worshipers, and you can trust a worshiper. I hear the Bible says that God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. But listen to the rest of the verse. For God seeketh such to worship him. Even God is looking for worshipers. I don't know if you're a worshiper. If you're a worshiper, it doesn't matter what's going on in your life. You can praise the Lord, knowing that God will bring you out. You can worship him with full assurance. A worshiper. Reuben was the person entitled to the birthright. Reuben was the firstborn, but he couldn't be trusted. But Judah, the worshiper, when he stood up and said to Jacob, I'll be surety, Jacob said, you can have him. Because he knows that if a man worship, God will make a way for that man. If a man worship, God will fight for that man. If a man worships, I want somebody near to understand. God's not going to make a way for you because you look good. Or you have on nice cologne. Or you wear some expensive perfume. or you're wearing an all silk designer's dress. That's not what impresses the Lord. The Lord is impressed by the intensity of your worship. The Lord is impressed by your predisposition to open your mouth and give him credit and give him praise and give him honor. Oh, if there's a Judite in here, stand up, open your mouth and worship him. My time is gone. My time is gone. But I got to make a couple, I want to make some observation here about a worshiper. And I got to get to the text, but I must make this observation. If you're a worshiper, you need to understand something from the text. Sherry, if you're a worshiper, the text tells us something. That worshipers can stand surety. And by surety, it means co-sign. A worshiper can co-sign for you. You know, if your credit ain't right, a worshiper can, a co-sign is a person that signs and get you through. And that's what the Bible says a worshiper is like. A co-signer. He stands surety. And Judah stood up and said to his father, I stand surety. I certify that I'm going to bring him back. Give him to me. I stand surety. Some of you need to certify your children and certify your friends. Some of you got some situations. Only if you're a worshiper. Now, if you're a cutie, this ain't for you. If you're a cutie pie, sit down. Stay where you are. But if you're a worshiper, you can stand surety. If you're a worshiper, you can be a co-signer. If you're a worshiper. This is for people. Oh, I don't know if I can go any further. Yeah. Oh, hallelujah. Hey. Oh, Bobo Shata Baba Yaba. Hallelujah. Hey. Bobo Shata Baba Yaba. Hey, Bobo Shata Baba. Oh, the Lord is in this place. That's it. Just leave her alone. The Lord is in this place. And surety. Hey. Can stand surety. Ah, my word. Oh, hallelujah. Hey. Oh, glory. This is only for worship. If you're not a worshiper, you need not apply.